catch.
What I'm doing is I'm widening out one of the bands. I like to load it beforehand because whenever you're down to one hand, it's a little tough to band them. So I'll set that one there. Start off with you. Okay. This bird has never not been banded. It does not have a band on the leg. So the first thing I'll do is I'll secure a leg. They don't even feel it because the band slides right over the top of the leg. And that cinches it down really good. I double check the number. It's a 9.5. So I go to my data sheet. I got 9.5. And this is site A. This bird is an adult. So the code is AHY, adult hatch year. And it's a male.
Okay, so how do you know it's an adult?
Okay, I will go through that real quick here. The first thing you do is you look at the coverts up in this area here, and you look for a little buff. If you've got like little buff edges around those feathers, then if you have one or two that has that, automatically it nullifies it being an adult. It is an immature bird. And we don't have that. Another telltale thing, this bird's actually in really good condition. A lot of the birds that stick around for the year will actually start to lose parts of the ends of their toes and their toenails. Their legs tend to be a little more reddish than the immatures. And also, if I don't lose it, you can see the really, the peach color along with the slate blue on the top of the head. That's telltale for males. They tend to have a little bit more of the iridescence. I don't know if that shows up in the camera, but a little more of the iridescence on the side also. So that's an adult male. I'll quickly release him. And see what we get on the next bird. Always try to catch them where their head goes between my fingers so that I can cradle them and not hurt them any. This bird's actually been banded already. And I can tell by the prefix on it that it's probably one of the birds we banded this year. So this is one of the dummies that came back to the trap. So I write that down on recaptures. Five, four, six, six, three. Okay. This bird, if I was banding it, it's a female. And the way you tell a female is they have a lot less color around the head. You can still see that it has a little blue around its eye. It's pretty common with all the adults. Does not have the peach color that the male had up in here. It's all pretty much a uniform color up here. And you don't get it near as much iridescence, if any. This one hardly has any of the iridescence. Still has the red legs of an adult. And there are no buff edges around the contours. These are typical of a female adult bird. Let's get this one here. New bird. All right. I'm gonna put a band on it before I talk about it because that's the important thing is to get the bird banded. Lock down the band. I'm going to record it real quick. Okay. This is an immature bird. Actually, it's a very young immature bird. You can see on the coverts the little light buff lines around those little feathers up there on the front of the wing. The wings are so much more small and dainty than the adults. And the head really kind of has a couple little stripes rather than the dot. A lot of times you'll see a little bit of the two stripes on the sides. The leg is not as red as the adult. It's more of a, just kind of a skin color almost, maybe a little bit pinkish. And the bird is so much smaller in size. This is actually a very young one. He's probably not been flying for too many weeks.
And this one doesn't have the blue eye.
Correct. Ring. Does not have the blue eye ring at all. There's very little color to him at all. More camouflaged.
But at this point in time, can you tell it's a male or a female?
No. And that's one of the things that's, I can't call it a trick question whenever somebody's learning how to band these. These automatically go down as an immature, obviously. So when the coat is a hatch year. All hatch year birds go as an unknown because there's no way to really tell the sex. As they get a little later in the trapping period, they kind of show some of the characteristics of either male or female, but it's still too early to really call it. So the prudent thing to do is to put an unknown, put a U on it. It's okay to be unknown. I'll set this bird for release. I think he's gonna go right away.
Okay, tell us about the bands.
Okay. These bands are actually distributed to the states. And so there's a database in Maryland where all of the birds are recorded after we do the banding. We send the data in. They keep all that data there. And so there's a little diary on this bird. There's a high number of these birds. This is the last recording they get. But there's some that get caught the following year or maybe 2 or 3 years after that. I've had some birds that I banded over by Charleston that I banded 6 years after, or collected them 6 years after I banded them. So some of them actually do return. A fair amount of these birds are residents here and they'll stick around. We had a little bit of a north breeze, but not much of a cold front. When we start getting cold fronts, a lot of these young birds will start moving down. And so you get new birds. And I may be catching birds that some of my cohorts up in the northern part of the state banded the week before. So that bird will be recorded as, if I get one of those, it'll be recorded as a reband. And then we'll have that data also. If the bird gets harvested maybe a year later, then obviously that's the end of the book. That's the end of the story for that bird. But we have all that data for that. So. It's really good information so we can get some locations of where these birds were found and together with other data that we then have a little bit of a case for where the birds are going in their migration.
So if somebody does harvest a banded bird, the information for where to report that is actually on the band?
Yeah, it's actually on there. There's a website that you can get on to record that number, and the person who records it then can keep the band and as a souvenir or whatever, and that data then goes to the database. We'll send them a certificate, a thank you basically certificate, with the information in there of when and where that bird was banded originally. So you get the original banding on that. I think we can let this little dude go. Off he goes. All right. Target dude out of here. You gotta watch these little finches because they can bite you. That one knew the door was open. Yeah, this is just a little house finch female. And I guarantee the way these things are, tomorrow when I'm banding, they'll be right back. they get a freebie. I swear they know we're gonna let them go. And so I'm out of band, so I'm gonna let this bird go.
Well, tell me a little bit about the timing of the dove banding program. When do you start, and ideally, when is it that you're ending?
We actually start baiting these sites and trying to get birds feeding constantly on the bait so they get real comfortable to getting fed every day here. then those, a lot of times when we're doing that, we're getting a lot more of the adults. Some of these birds, like this one, was probably sitting in a nest. It was probably a fledgling. So we'll get more of the adults that are coming in here. The adults then bring the young ones, and the young ones get used to feeding on it. And so our first catches can be really good because of that. So that's how we try to plan that out.
And the program goes basically until you have fulfilled your quota of the number of bands that you're given?
Yeah, there's where you either fill our quotas, we get within the due date before the season starts, so that we don't get anybody into a baiting situation. So if hunters decided they wanted to hunt somewhere in this area, we want the bait cleaned up here so that they don't get any kind of violations.
How long have you worked for the Department of Natural Resources?
Oh boy, I started in 89.
1989. So you've been banding birds every year since 1989?
No. I started as a private land biologist in 91. And trying to think back, I became a district biologist, I believe it was 96. And I started banding, my gosh, I think this is probably my 15th year of banding for the Department of Natural Resources. In a prior life, I worked for the Corps of Engineers at Lake Shelbyville and banded birds over there two different summers. So I had a little bit of experience banding birds before I came on at the department, but those that doesn't count. I usually band every year for, I think, the last 15 years, and most of those years, somewhere between 300 and 400 birds that we band here.
So any unique oddity story?
Oh my gosh, there's so many, yeah. Walking up to a bullfrog that's in a trap, I still don't know what drew that frog into the trap. We get a lot of, you know, obviously we got a non-target red-winged blackbird in here right now and a finch, but we get a lot of things that come in, squirrels and rabbits and a trap in a site. One time there was a parking lot, and of course there was nothing really stopping the trap from sliding across the parking lot, and it had a groundhog in it. It's kind of like a race car ripping across the parking lot trying to get a hold of that trap to let it go, but yeah, we get a lot of crazy things. The one thing we really don't want to have, and unfortunately does happen with this operation at times, is predation. We do get especially avian predation. Usually it's Cooper's hawks that'll find a trap site, and the best thing that we can do is just to flip the traps, let it sit for a week, and let those hawks get back to feeding on stuff they need to be feeding on and not on our birds, and then we can go back to trapping. But yeah, that's one of the things that we try to look for. And it's one of the reasons why we have multiple trap sites, so that we can move from one place to the other if there's a problem.